Tantal Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Origin of Names, Words, and Everything in Between, Volume 2, by Patrick Foote, narrated by Jonathan Cowley. Hello again. Well, here we are again. For lack of a better term and at the risk of sounding a tad too cheesy, the adventure continues. I hope you are all just as excited as myself to look into the origins of more names, words, and everything in between. Looking back at that first book feels like the tip of the iceberg, and believe me, this is quite a big iceberg. Simply due to the fact that these books are all about uncovering how things got their names. Luckily for name nerds like myself, and for the etymologically excitable like yourself, everything has a name. So it's time to dive back into the world of word origins yet again. Once again, I have found a plethora of names and words to share and explain to you all. Like last time, this book is split into themed sections, covering names that fit neatly into that section. From the most popular thing in that area, which you may have always wondered about, to how it got its name, to some lesser known but enjoyably named things. I'm sure you understand, this is the sequel after all, and who reads the sequel book first? You have read the first book, haven't you? Well, just in case there's anyone out there who is leaping into volume 2 before reading volume 1, let's have a quick recap of things, shall we? Who am I? The name of the person who wrote this book all about names is Patrick Foote. That's me, by the way. Not quite sure why I wrote that in the third person. I have been studying etymology and word origins for roughly 5 years or so now. Though I must admit, when I say studying word origins, I don't mean studying them in some fancy library at a well-respected university or at some cushy educational job. I study word origins primarily in my basement or sometimes in a coffee shop if I'm starting to scratch at the walls. As I study word origins for my YouTube channel, NameExplain, which is all about pretty much what it sounds like, explaining names. The channel had pretty humble beginnings. It started as something to do when I wasn't stacking the shelves of a supermarket during my day job. As the channel grew, I had to take risks, from leaving university where I was studying words to leaving the supermarket that paid my bills to leaving my parents and their home, which had always been a safety net for me. Yet those risks paid off, as NameExplain is now one of the most popular YouTube channels focusing on etymology. It has allowed me to make uncovering etymologies my full-time job and even given me the chance to write these books, something that I am eternally grateful for. So while I may not have the academic credentials or a degree in the field, and I never claim to be a professional by any means, I do have a burning passion for word origins and plenty of experience Googling answers, so you're in safe hands. At least, I think so, anyway. What is etymology? I have already used that big word a couple of times now, etymology. It's a word that came to us from the Greeks with their word etymologia, meaning to find the true origins of a word. It's basically a fancy word for word origins, but it's one I love, so I'll be using it quite a lot in this book. Etymologies can come from a huge variety of places. As we just saw with the word etymology itself, words can come from ancient roots. Greek and Latin often play a large role, especially with the English language, so I have no doubt those languages will be popping up again in this book. However, words can come to us through all kinds of etymologies. Some words are formed when we put other words together, like how the word armchair is just the words arm and chair put together. Sometimes we use a whole string of words that become a mouthful to say every time, so we just take the first letter of each word and use that as a word unto itself. like how the self-contained underwater breathing apparatus was shortened to just scuba. Sometimes words are named after people or places important to them. Sometimes they have fun stories linked to them, and sometimes they are just made up out of thin air. All etymologies are exciting in their own way, that's for sure. And while every word does have an etymology, sometimes the passage of time, means, and lack of ancient information means we aren't exactly sure what that etymology is. The greatest struggle of any etymologist is that the spoken word can't be preserved like a dinosaur bone or an ancient piece of pottery. Some of the greatest unsolved mysteries we have still are the unknown origins of words. But that's incredible unto itself. Take the word dog. No one exactly knows where the word dog came from. Isn't it amazing that a word so commonplace as dog can also be equally mysterious? What etymologies are in this book? As mentioned, Volume 1 was the tip of the iceberg. With that book, I wanted to cover the big picture, obvious topics. If you were to ask someone to name things that have names, it would have been the topics of Volume 1: countries, animals, towns, objects, planets, etc. While I could have easily found more entries on those same topics, but this time I went for completely new topics. Topics and themes from a huge variety of different fields. There are some less obvious topics covered this time around, that's for sure, but of course, everything has a name, so anything is up for covering, no matter how niche it may seem. I also wanted to somewhat look at the other side of the coin in regard to the various subjects I covered last time. In Volume 1, we looked at countries and cities on our planet today. This time around, we look into former historic places that used to be on our globe. And we shone a huge spotlight on the animal kingdom last time around. So this time, let's shine a light on the plant kingdom instead and give the planet's greenery the recognition it deserves. I still do cover some pretty obvious stuff in this book too. How did I fail to talk about bodies of water in the last book? And colours for that matter? Though perhaps most shocking is that in the last book, I failed to properly talk about the most commonplace names on our planet. The names of us. We all have names, and it's these first names I want to talk about first. First names. First name, given name, Christian name, whatever you want to call it. It's something pretty much all of us have. They are something that come to define us. Your first name is pretty much you. When people think of names, it's most likely these kinds of names that come to mind first. What's also great with first names is that they all have a meaning, some of those not as great as others. The names I have chosen here were picked for a variety of reasons. I wanted to uncover the origins of some of the world's most popular names, reveal some odd meanings for other popular names, and share with you all some names from around the world you may not have heard of before. Anyway, let's have some fun with first names. Oliver. In many parts of the world, especially in English-speaking countries, Oliver is one of the most popular boy names there is. So it only seemed fitting to start things off with perhaps the most popular name. Despite being such a popular name at the moment, we don't have one definitive idea as to where the name came from. Most sources agree that it came to England with the Normans in 1066 as the Norman name Olivier, but as to how the Normans got that name, we have a couple of ideas. One idea is that it came from Latin and their word oliva, which fittingly means olive tree. The Romans loved olives. Of course, they are tasty, but the Romans and other residents of the ancient Mediterranean saw them as more than just a delicious snack. The olive and its tree came to be a symbol of peace. We still use the term extend the olive branch today when we are seeking peace with someone. It makes all the sense in the world that a fruit this beloved would create a first name. Another theory for its origin isn't quite as fruity. It's also thought that the Norman name Olivier came from the Middle Low German name Alfihar, which means things along the lines of elf host or even elf army. The idea of hosting elves sounds pretty cool to me, and the idea of having an army of elves sounds even cooler, though maybe that's just me being too much of a geek. Nevertheless, either the Latin Oliva or the Middle Low German Alfihar went on to become the Norman Olivier, which was brought to England where it became Oliver and would eventually take the baby-naming world by storm. Mallory. While certainly a pretty-sounding name, which garnered it a spike in popularity in the 1980s, its meaning is not as pretty. In fact, this name is rather unfortunate, quite literally. No, seriously, the name Mallory means exactly that, unfortunate. Once again, this is a name of French origins, coming from the old name of malheur, meaning unfortunate or unlucky. The real question here is why would we create a name with such an unenjoyable meaning to begin with? Well, to understand that, we have to understand how we created names as a whole to begin with. Pretty big concept stuff for only entry 2, I know. Lots of first names started life as surnames. However, surnames became a thing after first names. To begin with, we all just had one name. As places got more populated, many people would have the same first name, meaning extra names were needed to help differentiate people. People started adding extra names to the end of their first names to help them stand out. These second names became known as bynames, basically just old nicknames. These bynames could be inspired by where they lived or what they did for work, just to name a few examples. Eventually, people started to take great pride in their bynames and pass them on to their children, hence how we created the modern concept of a surname. So how does Mallory fit into all this? Well, as well as being inspired by jobs and homes, bynames could also be inspired by the characteristics of the people who had them. It must have been the case that the French byname of Malheur was given to some unlucky and unfortunate people. As a byname for the downtrodden, it became an inherited surname and then became the first name Mallory as we know it today. What's great is that despite this gloomy meaning, it hasn't stopped people from choosing the name after all these years. Calvin. Calvin is yet another name that doesn't have the greatest of meanings. Calvin has similar roots to Mallory. It too started out as a name given to people due to a characteristic of the holder of the name. Yet, instead of being a metaphysical characteristic like being unfortunate, it was a physical characteristic that inspired it. Calvin dates all the way to ancient Rome with the cognomen of Calvinus. A cognomen is pretty much the ancient Roman equivalent of the bynames we talked about earlier, in which someone would be honored with an additional name that reflected them personally. So what did the cognomen of Calvinus mean? Well, it meant bald, as in not having any hair upon your head. So when this name made its way into English as the first name Calvin, it still meant bald. Okay, so maybe I'm being too harsh on the name Calvin. There's honestly nothing wrong with being bald. It's a natural thing. Yet, human society has made balding a laughing matter. So much so that when I read that a first name means bald, I can't help but find it funny. I'll try my best not to be as baldest in the future. Apologies to any Calvins or bald people reading this book right now. Though this also explains to us why, in Spanish, the word for bald is calvo, as Spanish is a language that relates deeply to Latin. Jessica. We all know the classic story about the name Jessica. It was a name created by the bard himself, William Shakespeare. Well, while Will did do an awful lot for the English language, and yes, the earliest source we have for the name does come from his play The Merchant of Venice, to declare that he created the name Jessica out of thin air isn't quite the case. The popular idea is that Shakespeare moulded the name Jessica from an ancient, already existing name, that name being the ancient biblical name of Iska, which itself derives from the Hebrew roots of Yiska. The name wasn't too prevalent in the pages of the Bible. Most noticeably, it belonged to a niece of Abraham. It means to behold. And when the bard stumbled upon this name, he must have liked it so much that he retooled it into the name Jessica, and to this day, Jessica is still seen as having the meaning to behold. While on the subject of names created by Shakespeare, other names he lays claim to are Olivia, Miranda, Perdita, Florizel, Imogen, and Othello. But like with the name Jessica, he didn't create these names out of thin air, but crafted them from words and names already established in the language. Alexander. This is a name held by some of the greatest figures in history, from the inventor of the telephone, Alexander Graham Bell, to founding US father, Alexander Hamilton. The name, however, started life as a nickname for one specific person, that being the legendary Greek figure of Paris, whose name has nothing to do with the city, in case you were wondering. Paris's most notable story from Greek mythology is when he eloped with Helen of Troy, which sparked the famous Trojan War. However, as a young man, he helped many and defended those who needed help. In one instance, he helped some shepherds whose flock of sheep were being stolen. The shepherds thanked him for his help and gave him the title of Alexandros. This title comes from two Greek words, alexein, which means to defend slash ward off, and aner, which means man. So this title is seen as meaning defending men slash defender of men, which is a pretty darn heroic meaning if I do say so myself. Of course, this name would go on to become a first name and morph into Alexander. It would also eventually be given to someone even more heroic than Paris of the Greek myths, that being Alexander III of Macedon, more known by his title of Alexander the Great. As king of the ancient kingdom of Macedonia, he won countless wars and claimed huge amounts of land. As a great war leader, it was only fitting he too bear this name Alexander, which means defender of man. Lakeisha. African American culture has a rich history with inventive first names, and Lakeisha is a prime example of this. African American names have drawn inspiration from a huge variety of sources, whether that be from the continent of Africa or the United States. Another large influence on African American names is the French language, as France in the past laid claims to various parts of the Americas, such as the area that now makes up the state of Louisiana, or the land that makes up the modern nation of Haiti. Both these areas still have a variation of French spoken in them. These areas would have been populated with African Americans too, so the French language impacted them and their names. The la at the start of the name Lakeisha comes from French roots. In French, it simply means the, and we see French prefixes in a few African American names, like DeMarcus or LeBron. What about the Keisha part then? Well, there seem to be two main theories as to where this part of the name comes from. One idea is that it comes from African roots, meaning favorite. However, I find it odd that most sources that say this don't specify an exact African language, because obviously Africa isn't just one single nation where they all speak the same tongue. The idea with more evidence is that it comes from the Hebrew name of Keziah, which means cinnamon. This might sound odd, but remember, Cinnamon comes from a tree and, as we established with Oliver, it's not a weird thing to name people after trees. Before we continue, I must stress that while I have been calling this an African-American name, that doesn't mean it has only been used by African-American people. Lakeisha, like many other names, is undoubtedly a creation of Black Americans, though it's used far and wide. Muhammad. Many argue that Muhammad is the most popular name in the world. That's kind of true and not true. While it is popular and many do have the name, it's not the number one name in a lot of nations. The primary reason this is the case is because there are quite a few spelling variations of the name, including Muhammad, Muhammad, Mihamad, and Muhammad, just to name a few examples. When we include all these different spelling variations, then Muhammad does quite possibly become the world's most popular name. Though none of these individual spellings of the name lay claim as the world's most popular. Regardless of whether it's number one in the world or not, you can't argue that it is a darn popular name. The reason behind its popularity is the religion of Islam. The Prophet of Islam has this name too. This means that many Muslim parents choose to give their sons the same name as their prophet, as he is seen as the embodiment of excellence, and it's hoped that by sharing the prophet's name, they too will lead a life like the prophet Muhammad. As for where the name comes from, however, it's thought to derive from the Arabic verb of hamida, which means to praise. So in turn, the name Muhammad is seen as meaning things like praised, praiseworthy, and even commendable. It's fitting that someone so praised and beloved by so many people around the world has a name meaning just that. Hina. This simple name has become common in a few Asian languages. It is most noticeable, however, as a Japanese female name. As this name is Japanese, it means that it's not usually spelt with the Latin alphabet of English and other Latin-based languages. More often than not, it is spelt with kanji, characters that represent entire words or phrases, unlike the characters of our alphabet that represent individual sounds. The name Hina isn't created from just one or two sets of kanji characters, however. One source points out that the name Hina can be created in Japanese through over 100 different kanji combinations and variations. That also means that all these different kanji combos that create the name Hina give it different meanings too. The most popular idea is that the name Hina means light slash sunshine, though others claim that the name means male, which is odd considering it's primarily a girl's name, or that it means vegetation. A troubling thing with kanji is that those symbols can be interpreted to mean a variety of different things. Nevertheless, Hina is a pretty sounding name, regardless of what kanji characters you spell it with. Santiago. As well as being a first name across the Spanish and Portuguese-speaking world, Santiago is also a surname and a place name. There are many settlements with this name, including the capital of Chile. This is also a name that comes from religious origins. The first part of this name is pretty easy to understand. It comes from the Spanish santo and means saint. As I said, it is a religious name, so yes, this name comes from a saint of Christianity. And what I like about this name is that despite the fact that these saints already have first names which kids could be named after, their title of saint is being used as an actual first name. Though what saint specifically does the name Santiago relate to? Saint Iago? Well, kind of. The latter part of this name comes from the name Iago, which is an old Spanish form of the name James. So Santiago is a name that means Saint James. As I mentioned, why not just call your kid James if you want to name them after the saint? Though not only did St. James give us the name of Santiago, but also the name Santiago eventually got shortened into its own name entirely, Diego. Well, that's one theory as to how the name Diego came about anyway. Wangari. Kenya is home to the Kikuyu people, who make up roughly 17% of the entire Kenyan population. This name of Wangari is a girl's name from the Kikuyu language. It is thought to come from their word Ngari, which means leopard in their tongue. Leopards are pretty cool animals to be named after, that's for sure. Especially considering that animal-based names aren't all too common in the English-speaking world. The name Wangari itself is best known to the Kikuyu people in their creation myth. One of the nine daughters of their creation goddess Mumbi was named Wangari. Mumbi is also used as a girl's name in Kikuyu, meaning she who creates or she who builds, which are pretty cool, but not quite as cool as being named after a leopard, in my eyes. Historic places. The world as we know it today hasn't always been this way. Our blue ball has been floating in space and has changed dramatically over the years. Borders that once existed on maps have been erased and redrawn. Grand cities that once stood are now rubble. And even the land we walk on has split apart, merged, and moved across the planet. In Volume 1, we spent a good amount of time looking into the names of places on our planet. This time around, I want to step back in time and marvel upon the historical places on our planet that are no longer here, or at least don't exist in the same way they did at the peak of their power. The names I have chosen here include former countries, cities, regions, and empires ranging from the not-too-distant past all the way back to before we humans were even here. Mesopotamia. This is quite possibly the most important place in human history. Often known as the cradle of civilization, Mesopotamia is where we humans stopped being hunter-gatherers and started forming societies like the ones we know today. The wheel, math and writing are all inventions of those who lived in Mesopotamia. Life was able to kickstart in such a way here due to a variety of factors, including the fertility of the soil in the area and the climate. Parts of the modern nations of Iraq, Iran, Kuwait, Syria, and Turkey in Western Asia, on the cusp of the Arabian Peninsula, are where Mesopotamians resided. Mesopotamia wasn't a single kingdom or nation, but rather the name for the land various tribes and people thrived in, such as the Babylonians and Sumerians. They for sure didn't call the land Mesopotamia either. It's a name given to the land retroactively by the Greeks, so it's of Greek origin. As mentioned, the people of ancient Mesopotamia could thrive because the soil there was so darn fertile, meaning farming could be achieved. The reason this soil was so good to farm on was because Mesopotamia resided between two rivers that enhanced the soil there, these two rivers being the Tigris and Euphrates. Its position in the middle of two rivers is why it now has the name Mesopotamia, as this name comes from the Greek words of meso, which means middle, and potamos, meaning river. So the name simply means land in the middle of rivers. This Greek meso is seen in names of other parts of the world too, like the name Mesoamerica, which
we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.